Hello, I'm Hannah, and this is Hannah's Books. Welcome to another Reads and Rambles, where I talk at irregular intervals about bookish things and other things that have been happening in my life over the last week or two or three. Often in my Reads and Rambles videos, I talk about some of the book review or otherwise bookish periodicals I've been reading. One that I bring up almost every time in some way or another is the New York Times Book Review, often abbreviated as the NYTBR. What I only just realized is that it is the NYTBR. Did y'all already realize this? It made me inordinately happy to see a link between the online bookish community's use of To Be Read connected to the much older TBR of the book review. Silly, I know, but still. Those of you who have watched my Reads and Rambles before know that my favorite part of the book review is often the By the Book feature. Even when I get irritated by some interviewee that doesn't actually seem to read or care about books in any way. This past week's edition was not in that category, but it took me a while to warm up to the interview. This time, By the Book asked bookish questions of Ibram X. Kendi of anti-racist fame, and his first few answers clearly indicate that he is interested in books. What disappointed me was that his answers are mostly long lists of books he recommends. The second question he answers is about classic books he's read recently, and he names Nell Larson's Passing, one of my favorites, as well as other important books written during the Harlem Renaissance. He even gives a shout-out to Penguin Classics, and I mean literally as that phrase can mean in print. Quote, shout out to Penguin Classics. His list also includes several classics which talk about the theme of colorism, and then pivots to list a few contemporary novels which also address that theme. Making that link is interesting, but what makes me love the By the Book feature is when authors express what these books mean to them, not when they just give bookish advice from this platform the New York Times has given them. My favorite question is not a typical By the Book question. You're at the forefront of a recent wave of authors combating racism through active, sustained anti-racism. How do you advise readers to approach books like The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn, books with conflicted or hard-to-parse racial attitudes? My first thought was that the question was a setup, that is, that Kendi wrote the question himself and gave it as a possibility to the New York Times. But after reading his answer, I don't think that was true. He starts the way one might expect. I'd advise readers of The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn to ensure they're also reading, and then he gives a long list of what I see as crucial nonfiction works about race and racism in America, written by serious black and white scholars and thinkers. One, in fact, a phenomenal study written by one of my friends from graduate school. The collection of books that Kendi mentions can, quote, nurture an anti-racist critical eye. He follows up with a discussion of how important it is to read all literature with a critical eye, and interestingly compares that to the importance of being critically minded as we, quote, read societies, past and present. I think what he means by reading critically here is being aware of how context matters, how it shapes how people think and write and act, how they construct what they think are appropriate power relationships, etc. What Kendi does not address in this question is that line about hard-to-parse racial attitudes, and that's an issue I really want to hear him talk about. Hard-to-parse doesn't mean exclusively racist, in need of balancing. It means not clearly anti-racist, but also pretty complicated. What would Kendi say? Do any of you know if he's done so elsewhere that I've just missed or forgotten about? Finally, in the very last question, one that led me to put together a BookTube tag along the same lines, Kendi responds to the question of which three authors he would invite to a dinner party, and his writing immediately comes to life and feels personal. I do wish his whole interview had had this kind of spark. I'll read his answer. I'd invite James Baldwin, Zoriel Hurston, and W.E.B. Du Bois. I can imagine Du Bois and Hurston having a spirited debate, leaving my guest riveted, with Baldwin functioning as interlocutor as he puffed his cigarettes and mostly sided with Hurston. Of course, they'd be debating the role of the Negro artist at my urging. At some point, I suspect Hurston would get tired of Du Bois and grab Baldwin and hit the music. Excellent answer. I've been talking so much about the New York Times Book Review, the NYTBR, in these videos lately, partly because for a long time I had not been receiving the bookish periodicals that are supposed to arrive in the mail. No London Review of Books, no New York Review of Books, the NYRB, not the NYTBR, which the newspaper delivery service drops at the base of our driveway every Sunday morning. No Times Literary Supplement, which was a special holiday gift to myself this year. But basically, they all arrived last week. I think I received 4 issues of the Times Literary Supplement in 4 days, and 3 issues of the London Review of Books. I also got a few other bookish periodicals I'll talk about next time. Sadly, I was in the middle of a big writing project and have not yet soaked myself in the periodicals yet, but the writing project is now done and turned in. I have a few other things to catch up on, but I think that stack of print journals is high on my reading list. What was the big writing project? I was writing my first book review for a print journal, one that is able to pay its writers. Although I've written more than a dozen reviews for the fantastic online journal Open Letters Review, which Steve Donahue helped start and continues to edit, the new review was roughly twice as long, and it took me quite a while to figure out how to target what I was writing to that length. In the past, I've written much longer pieces, but the 1,500-word length was new for me, and it took me a while to figure out how much detail I could include while still keeping the piece focused on large themes and my critique. While I'm not absolutely thrilled with what I submitted, I do think I learned a tremendous amount in the process. I promise to share the review with you when it comes out, which I think will be in May. I'll talk about the book I reviewed, Emily Medora Cowie's Out of the Shadows, 6 Visionary Victorian Women in Search of a Public Voice, then as well, since it doesn't come out until May either. Midori Kawa is also one of the authors of The Secret Sisterhood, The Literary Friendships of Jane Austen, Charlotte Bronte, George Eliot, and Virginia Woolf, a book which I've checked out of the library a few times, but never actually read. Have any of you read it? What did you think? In addition to the Midori Kawa book, I've been reading a bunch of other upcoming books for review, some of which I'll be talking about soon. And with the month of March upon us, with all its amazing read-alongs, I've started several other terrific books. One is for March Mystery Madness. Way back in December, Kate Howe made a fantastic series of videos recommending particular mystery authors or books to specific BookTubers. And one of the authors she suggested to me is Louise Penny, author of the Inspector Gamache series about a homicide detective and his team living in Quebec. For this month's celebration, I downloaded the audio of the first book in the series, Still Life, from my local library, and I've really been enjoying it so far. As usual, I'm pretty sure I figured out who the murderer is quite early. I'll know soon whether I was right or not, but as is the case of all the mysteries I love, that disclosure is not what makes me love a mystery book. Louise Penny has written a beautifully constructed book, fundamentally about characters and their relationships to each other. The writing is quite elegant, and Penny's focus on the importance of listening to solve murders, but also to be a kind human being living in community with other people, is an excellent addition. I've downloaded a few other mysteries, including another one Kate suggested in her list for me, and I hope I'll have time to listen to some of them during March. Another BookTube celebration this month is March of the Moderns, which I learned about from BookTuber and author Margaret Pennard. I fairly recently read the fascinating book Viral Modernism, The Influenza Pandemic and Interwar Literature by Elizabeth Outka. Her study considers the work of Virginia Woolf and T.S. Eliot, as well as Thomas Wolfe, Katherine Ann Porter, and Willa Cather, etc. I'm eager to read at least one of the works Outka discusses in her fascinating argument about how the so-called Spanish flu affected literature, which we often think of as shaped almost exclusively by the changes that occurred due to World War I. I think I briefly mentioned the book before, but I want to give a fuller discussion after I've been able to consider it back-to-back with some of the texts she analyzes. And last but not least, for the BookTube celebrations I want to participate in March, is March of the Mammoths. Maybe in January, I started listening to Red Comet by Heather Clark, the new and massive biography of Sylvia Plath, on audio, and I was really loving it. For complicated reasons, I lost access to the audio, but I don't yet have it back. But I hope I will soon. I'm right at the point where Plath is about to marry Ted Hughes, and there's quite a lot of book left. I also just received an early copy of Blake Bailey's rather thick new biography of Philip Roth. If you've been around this channel for any length of time, you may know that I'm not a huge Roth fan, to say the least. I'm hoping that this biography will open my eyes a bit in some of the same ways that Richard Greene's study of Graham Greene made me far more sympathetic to that author and his work. So, if I don't get audio access to Red Comet right away, I'll probably be starting the Roth instead. In addition to participating in these three March reading celebrations, I've been doing a few buddy reads. One is an almost year-long read of Michael Schmidt's Mammoth, the novel, a biography, along with Amy from A Dusty Bookshelf. I'm afraid I've been rather late for my weekly check-ins recently. While I'm not going to talk about the details of the chapters we've read this week, I will say that I was at first a little taken aback by the author's decision to talk about not just novels in more or less chronological order, which is the basic structure of the book. Instead, after the first few chapters, Schmidt starts pulling out themes and trying to make connections to more contemporary books. For example, in his chapter about Alfred Benn, Schmidt talks about Zora Neale Hurston as if the two were in conversation. I wasn't persuaded by his argument, but I must say that despite my skepticism, it's expanded what I take from both authors. And since that chapter, I've started to relax into the rather unusual, or at least rather personal, way of putting literature together. This evening, I'm hoping to read, belatedly, Chapter 8 about Samuel Richardson and Eliza Haywood and others. We'll basically hit the 19th century in about a month, and it won't be until then that there will be a fair amount of overlap between what Schmidt discusses and what I've read, rather than just an occasional book here or there. I very recently finished Cranford by Elizabeth Gaskell, with a phenomenal group of fellow BookTubers who I now will always think of as my fellow Cranford women. Roz from Scally Danling About the Books, Kim at Middle of the Book March, and Sarah at Hardcover Hearts. I first read this book immediately after I saw the screen adaptation, shown here in the States on PBS. My mother and I both really loved the show and talked about each episode on the phone after it aired. So I tried to read the book, and I just did not get hooked. I'd sort of written it off until I started watching BookTube and realized that many of the readers whose opinions I most respect count Cranford as a book they really love. Well, reading it slowly with Roz, Sarah, and Kim was fantastic. I mentioned earlier in this video that Louise Penny's mystery novel is fundamentally about kindness and acceptance of community. Well, Cranford is even more about kindness. I don't exactly remember why I didn't like it before. Was it because the plot was almost non-existent? That's possible, but I suspect it was because this level of kindness and gentleness in a book turned me off back then. I'm guessing it seemed almost confectionarily sweet. But I see more in it now, and certainly times have changed. After the last 4 years of hearing hateful speech dominating the airwaves, and then a whole year now of living with a pandemic affecting our lives, a little kindness and gentleness was just what I needed. And I got it from Gaskell, as well as from our own Cranford women. Thank you. I especially want to thank Kim, who pulled out some of the most beautiful interpretations of how Gaskell was able to show the deep meanings of doing right for our neighbors right at a moment when I was on the cusp of a bit of cynicism about the ending of the book. Having this conversation together is exactly why I love having bookish friends to talk with here on BookTube and our outgrowths from BookTube and elsewhere. And finally, one more buddy read. Alan at Big Hard Books and Classics and I have started reading Ralph Ellison's Invisible Man together. This is not a book about kindness and gentleness. And I suppose it's a really good thing that the book will ensure that I don't lapse into not wanting to see the pain and injustice that surrounds us. That is, not start pretending it's invisible. I've mentioned before that my son counts Ellison's book as one of the most powerful books he's read, and my husband recommends it as well. But I really struggled with the level of violence in the first chapter and found it disturbing enough that I think I had trouble making an emotional connection to the deeper theme. What's interesting, of course, is that the deeper theme is partly about violence, real and metaphorical, in the life of the protagonist and other African Americans. In other words, the intensity of the specific violence kept him from being able to feel its literary power and meaning, I think. Now I've made it past that part and through the next few chapters. I'll be checking with Alan right after I finish filming this video, although by the time I actually post this video, our buddy read will be fully underway, I think. All right, I think that's all for today's ramble. I hope you all have a good reading week ahead of you. Thanks for joining me here on Hannah's Books. See you soon.